सहनावतो सहनो भुनक्तो सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। अन्तर्यश्च बहिर्विधूततिमिरं ज्योतिर्मयं शाश्वतं स्थानं प्राप्य विराजते विनमता अज्ञानमुन्मूलयन् पश्यन् विश्वमपीदमुल्लसति यो विश्वस्य पारे परः तस्मै श्रीरमणाय लोकगुरवे शोकस्य हन्त्रे नमः तस्मै श्रीरमणाय लोकगुरवे शोकस्य हन्त्रे नमः।
The text begins by indicating the wrong line of thinking in the minds of the seekers. So, what is the wrong philosophy we all have? The wrong philosophy we have come to based on our superficial analysis of our experiences, action gives happiness. Now Bhagwan here is proving that it is not the action which gives happiness. In fact, Bhagwan is going to prove later that happiness is one's own nature. So then after having pointed out the defects of action, which we'll be seeing again later, now Bhagwan points out how the very same action when performed intelligently can liberate a seeker. When actions are performed unintelligently, these actions bind us. But when actions are performed in the right way, with the right attitude, these very same actions liberate us. So how should the actions be performed? Ishvara arpitam na ichchaya krutam. Perform all your duties dedicated to Lord. Ishvara arpitam. And at the same time, na ichchaya krutam. It should be done without any ichcha, without any desire. So yesterday we were analyzing this part. Na ichchaya krutam. What does it mean? So at the level of performance of action also, there should be no ichcha. When the results come, then also there should not be any ichcha, desire. So we are analyzing this part now. So what actually it means, na ichchaya krutam? Normally there is a tendency in us to choose the easier path. The mind asks us to take decision based on our likes and dislikes, whereas intellect asks us to take decision based on right and wrong. So normally we tend to take decision based on likes and dislikes. I like it, therefore let me do it. I don't like it, therefore let me not do it. How should our actions be? This is right, let me do it. This is wrong, let me not do it. So na ichchaya krutam means listen to your intellect. intellect take decisions based on rights and wrongs. Mind take decisions based on likes and dislikes. Don't listen to your mind, listen to your intellect. Na ichchaya krita means let not your ego dictate terms to you. See the bigger picture in life. You are a part of this cosmos. So every action of yours must be such that it helps dharma to get established in the universe. Individually, as a family member, I have certain likes and dislikes, but as a member of this cosmos, my duties may be totally different. The best example is the example of Arjuna himself. As a family member, he did not want to fight, killing one's own near and dear ones, the teachers, etc. So as a family member, when that situation is analyzed, and that is how he analyzed it, this is called Ichchaya Kritam. He said, Bhagwan, I don't want to fight. I don't want to kill them. They are my teachers. They are my relatives, near and dear ones. This is called Ichcha. Now remember, Arjuna came to the battlefield not as a family man. He came to the battlefield as an army man. So which role is bigger? Role as an army man is bigger or role as a family man is bigger? When I am an army man, my role is with regard to the entire nation. So that role becomes bigger. So always my decision should be such that I take up my bigger role. Whenever I compromise my bigger, I compromise. Sacrificing my bigger role and taking up the lower role, then that is called as Ichcha here or Sangam. These two paths are always available to us. The path of Shreyas, the path of Prayas. So what Bhagwan is asking us is, take up the path of Shreyas, that which is good, not that which is pleasant. The path of Prayas is the path of pleasant. Pleasant means, in the beginning it is very nice, it gives you a good feeling, but in the end, it leads to some tragedy. The path of compromise is called path of Prayas. Don't take up the path of compromise. Don't yield to temptation. Walk the path of righteousness. So all these things come under this one term, na ichchaya kritam. So then in this way when we live, we become a perfect instrument in the hands of God. So as far as a karma yogi is concerned, his goal is only one, how can I please God? So when you see, when you analyze situation through the eyes of God, then you become totally impartial. When you analyze situation through your egoistic likes and dislikes, through your egoistic inclination, you will never get a clear picture. Your likes and dislikes, your attachments will always blur your intellect. That clarity will never come. And this always happens in Chinmaya Mission. When the parents come for this Balavihar competition, when they find their child singing, they conveniently ignore the defects and they see only the good part. Any parent for that matter. Any mother or any father will love his or her child. So naturally when the love becomes thick, fault becomes thin. And then they, in the end, they come and fight. Swamiji, my child sang well, my child should get first. Isn't it? When you are so much attached to someone, you will not be able to think rightly. This happens in every field. Whenever there is intense attachment, now this is called Ichcha. Whenever there is intense attachment, your decision making ability will be paralyzed to a great extent. Greater the attachment, greater the paralysis which you will experience. Right decisions becomes impossible. Right judgment becomes impossible in life. Na ichchaya kritam. May not your action be tainted by attachment, by likes and dislikes. May your actions be guided by the principles of dharma, the principles of righteousness. This is the meaning. Na ichchaya kritam. Well, this is with respect to action. Now there comes with respect to the results. After having performed action, naturally the world will give you results. Every karma should have karma phala. So what should be your attitude? Na ichchaya kritam. May not your actions be guided by the results. Results has to come. Results will come. Kartura-ajnaya prapyate phalam. Who is the ordainer of results? It is Karta. Here Karta means the Lord. The Supreme Lord is the one who gives you results. And who is the Supreme Lord? He is omniscient. He knows everything. He knows every factor involved in giving that result. So naturally, He will give the result what you deserve. So as far as the result is concerned, you need not get stressed at all. The right results will come to you. It has to come to you. Karturajnaya prapyate phalam. So when the results come, what should be your attitude? Whether the results be good or bad, your mind should be at peace. No grumbling, no complaining. Na ichchaya kritam means let your mind be at peace. This is called as prasada buddhi. Ishvara prasada buddhi. Whatever comes to your life, accept it as prasada from Lord. Why should be accepted it cheerfully? All situations, all that which comes to your life should be accepted cheerfully, because number one, you are getting what you deserve. Number two, it is given by an omniscient Lord. Number three, it is given by a Lord who is impartial and just. Number four, it is given by a Lord who has unconditional love for you. So therefore, whatever He gives you will be the best for you. Because of all these reasons, whatever happens to your life should be accepted cheerfully. This is called as prasada buddhi. How do I know whether I have prasada buddhi or not? Look at the state of mind when you receive results from the world. What is the state of your mind? Is your mind disturbed? Then that is not prasada buddhi. Any disturbance of the mind is an indication that you are not happy with God's decision. When you express your unhappiness with regard to God's decision, then that is called a disturbed mind. Any disturbance of the mind is an expression of your immaturity. Because when you say, "Oh God, why me?" Now this is the meaning, disturbed mind means. What does it mean? When you express your unacceptance of God's decision, what is implied is, you know better than God. Right? Oh God, I know better than you. This is not what you are supposed to give me. This is the meaning. When you are showing your unreadiness to accept the result, you are telling indirectly that you know more than God. You know better than God. Isn't it? Therefore, it's an expression of foolishness. The wise person is the one, the mature person is the one who receives results with a cheerful mind. Yes, we accept when tragedies happen, when something unacceptable happen, mind is disturbed, no doubt. But the question is how quickly you bounce back to the state of equipoise. This is important. No doubt everyone will be shaken. But the question is how long you remain in that state of disturbance. The more mature you are, the quicker you come back, the quicker you bounce back. How do you bounce back? These are the fundamentals. God is omniscient. He gives what I deserve. Because He is the one who knows every factor involved in giving this result. To give a very small example, when a seed is sown in the soil, whether that seed should sprout or not, how many factors are involved to decide that? I may say that I have sown the seed, so I expect the seed to sprout. But whether the seed should sprout or not, it is decided by countless factors. The quality of the seed, the quality of the mud, soil, the temperature, the humidity, isn't it? Now, even if everything is fine, it is possible that some bird may come and eat it. So there are so many factors involved, and I know at the most one or two factors. How can I be the decision maker with respect to the results? So therefore, it is unwise from our part to dictate terms in life. Cheerful acceptance is the way of the wise. This is called na ichchaya kritam. Here ichcha means insistence on results. Now many times people ask, is it possible to perform action without expecting results? Because karma yoga, many times this is how it is translated. Performance of actions without expecting results. Now is it possible? It is never possible. Whenever we perform action, we do have expectation of results. But what is indicated here is, you may have expectation but don't have insistence. There is a difference. You may expect results, but there should not be any insistence. What is the difference? When you insist on something, you say, I want this and this and this alone. Anything else, I will not accept. This is called insistence. So in karma yoga, what you have to give up is not expectation. Whenever you perform any action, there is naturally an expectation. You expect something. But definitely you must give up insistence. Now how do I know whether I am having expectation or insistence? When the results come, how quickly you regain your peace of mind. This decides how strongly you are insisting. Greater the insistence, greater the time you will take to come back to your normal state. Simple. So in karma yoga, what we insist is to drop insistence. Right? Now, the question is, how does a karma yogi overcome the defects of action? So yesterday we had enumerated 6 defects of action. I hope you remember. What is the first one? All actions are limited. Limited actions gives limited results. Limited results can at the most give limited happiness, and we are not happy with limited happiness. Now how does a karma yogi overcome this defect? A karma yogi never expects happiness from results. He knows that happiness is my nature. I don't have to depend on the results of the world to become happy. Thus, he overcomes the first defect. Second defect. What is the second defect? Every result in this world is unpredictable. When you attach yourself to an unpredictable result, you become tensed, worried, anxious, etc. You become disturbed. How does a karma yogi escape this? As far as a karma yogi is concerned, what is his first priority? His first priority in life is not results. His first priority is to please God. The only question he asks is, God, are you pleased with me? These are the instruments you have given. With these instruments, I have done my best. Now, if you are pleased, matter is over. As far as he is concerned, results are secondary and most unimportant, insignificant. So naturally, since he is not attached to the results, the unpredictability of the results does not create any disturbance for him. This is how he overcomes the second defect. What is the third defect? Actions create vasanas and thus make you a slave of mind. Actions, when performed with likes and dislikes, create vasanas, and these vasanas ultimately make you a slave of your mind. Now, as far as a karma yogi is concerned, remember, he is not performing action based on likes and dislikes. He is performing action based on rights and wrongs. And therefore, no such vasanas are created in him. He is performing action not according to his whims and fancies. He is performing actions in order to please God. So therefore, these actions don't create any vasanas. He becomes a master of his mind. Third one. Fourth one. What is the fourth one? A karmi performs action in order to get the results from the world. So naturally, he becomes dependent on the world. He becomes a slave of the world. Whereas a karma yogi becomes a master of the world because he doesn't depend on the world at all. He depends on God. His actions are God-dependent, not world-dependent. Thus, he becomes a master of the world also. This is defect number 4. Defect number 5. What is that defect? Whenever you perform an action, the identification with your body, mind, intellect becomes stronger and stronger. Because with the understanding that I am this body, mind, intellect, with this understanding, whenever you perform action, your identification with your body becomes stronger. You are bound to your matter envelopment. How does a karma yogi overcomes it? Karma yogi says, Bhagwan, this is your instrument. I am only a caretaker of your instrument. He doesn't say, this is me. This body is given by you. This mind is given by you. This intellect is your gift. I am only a caretaker. Now suppose somebody gives you 100 rupees or say some amount, some money he gives and say, after 1 month I will collect it from you. So in this 1 month when that money is with you, do you feel that this money is mine? No, isn't it? Because you know that after 1 month this person is going to collect from me. In the same way, each and every one of us, we are given this BMI, body, mind, intellect. A time comes when this BMI will be taken away from you. A karma yogi is very well aware of this fact. So he keeps this BMI just as a gift given by someone which will be taken away. So naturally, he has no identification even when he is performing actions with his BMI. Thus, there is no identification. He overcomes the 5th defect. What is the 6th defect? Every karma produces karma phala, and in order to enjoy this karma phala, you have to take birth again and again to this world. This is the 6th defect. What about a karma yogi? Karma yogi says, Bhagwan, I am your instrument. You are the doer. I am only your instrument. So who is the doer? Bhagwan becomes the doer. So who is the karta? Bhagwan is the karta. So who should become the bhokta, enjoyer? Bhagwan himself. He escapes. Karma belongs to God. So naturally karma phala also should belong to God. So therefore he escapes this birth-death cycle. In this way, all the defects of action, a karma yogi escapes. Right. I think for the time being, this is enough. Now we have to move forward because this is not the main topic of Upadeshasara. Now a very interesting question. We find that this prasada buddhi, whatever has been mentioned here, Ishvara arpana buddhi, prasada buddhi, etc., it becomes natural to us whenever we visit holy places. Whenever you go to an ashram, prasada buddhi becomes natural. Whenever you go to some saint or a sage, all these virtues becomes natural to us. Accepting all situation with a cheerful mind, it comes natural to us. But in the family, it is difficult. In the office, it becomes difficult. Any temple you go, whatever the pujari gives as a prasad, you just accept it without any complaint, without any grumbling, isn't it? It may be a rotten piece of banana. It may be some dirty water. We don't know the source of that water. But the pujari is giving. What is our attitude? Oh, it is coming from God. So even without thinking what he gives, we just take it. So this attitude of prasada bhavana becomes natural to us when we visit temples, when we go to some ashrams. All these virtues automatically manifest. But why is it that we are not able to manifest these virtues in our workplace or in our family? So then we find that whenever I operate in this world as a devotee, I am able to express these virtues naturally. So each and every one of us, we have so many roles to play in the society. The role of a father, role of a mother, of a husband, of wife, of children, as an employer, as an employee. And one among so many roles is role of a devotee. So when I go to a temple, which role becomes prominent? The role of a devotee becomes prominent. When I am in a family, the role of a husband or a wife becomes prominent. When I am in the office, the role of an employer or an employee becomes prominent, isn't it? But just imagine, suppose I am able to keep this role of a devotee, my primary role, let all the other roles be secondary, then I will find that wherever I go, I will be able to behave with great maturity. I will be able to respond to this world in a better way. I will be able to exhibit my virtues in every place. Isn't it so? Now, how to do that is the question. I do find that whenever I give this devotee role the highest priority, when I operate in this world as a devotee, I am able to accept situations cheerfully without complaint. Now, how to make this devotee role stronger? This is the question. If only I can make this devotee role the primary role, let all the other roles in life, let it be secondary. I am primarily a devotee who is a husband. I am primarily a devotee who is a wife, etc. If this is the way I live, then many of the problems can be easily solved. Because when you give importance to devotee role, you are remembering God. Right decisions are taken. Mind is freed from all kinds of attachments. And whenever you are free from all kinds of attachments and disturbances, naturally your interaction with the world will be healthier. Now the question is, how to make this devotee role stronger? The role of a devotee in us can be strengthened if we strengthen our relationship with God. This is the way. Now the question is, how to strengthen my relationship with God? Your relationship with God can be strengthened when you spend more time with God. Now the question is, how can I spend more time with God? In what way? So then, our scriptures prescribe so many ways. How to spend time with God? In what way you can capture God? Hold on to God. Now, any object has got these three. What are they? Name, form, nature. These are the three things which every object has. So, if you want to understand an object, these are the three important things. What are they? Name, nama, form, rupa, nature, guna. Nama, rupa, guna. So now my goal is to strengthen my relationship with God, to spend time with God. Then what are the things which I must make use of? Make use of these three. Nama, rupa, guna. So accordingly, our scriptures have given certain sadhanas holding on to these three. What are those sadhanas? Let us chant verse number 4.
Kaya vangmanah karyamuttamam pujanam japas chintanam kramat. Kaya vangmanah karyamuttamam pujanam japas chintanam kramat.
So now, what are the spiritual practices one must adopt in order to develop this relationship with God? So here Bhagavan says, puja, japa and chintana. So in puja, the most important thing is form of the Lord. So you are holding on to the rupa of God. And then next one is puja, japa. In japa, what do you hold on to? Nama, the name of the Lord. And in chintana, you contemplate upon the nature of God, guna. So now what does Bhagavan say? Kaya vangmanah karyam. Kaya karyam pujanam. Vak karyam japah. Manah karyam chintanam. Kramat uttamam. These are the things you must do. Kaya karyam pujanam. With the body, you worship the Lord. This is called puja. So what is involved in puja? Your body is involved primarily. Your mind is also involved. Your speech is also involved. So in puja, all the three are involved. Your body, speech and mind. three supports are there. Next higher one is japa. Vakaryam japaha. Your speech is involved and also your mind is involved. When you do japa, speech as well as mind is involved. Body is not involved. And the third one, the higher one is chintanam, where japa is not involved, speech is not involved, only your mind is involved. Now, which is the higher, which is the lower? Bhagwan says, kramat uttamam. Puja, the lowest one, higher than that is japa, still higher is chintanam. Why is it higher? It is higher because higher you go, lesser the supports you have. If a child wants to learn cycling, what kind of cycle do you give? First you give a tricycle, isn't it? Three tires, so that the child can balance itself. But as the child picks up that balance, this tricycle becomes bicycle, correct? And if he joins circus, this bicycle becomes cycle with one tire, isn't it? And sometimes they ride this cycle on the rope also. Isn't it? In the same way, in the beginning, Bhagwan says, start with puja. Why start with puja? Because in puja, the possibility of the mind's wandering is minimum. Because there are a lot of supports. Your body is involved in worshipping the Lord. Your senses are also involved. Your eyes are seeing the form of the Lord. Ears are hearing the chantings. Right? The nose is smelling the agarbatti, the incense sticks. The beautiful form, decorated form. And the body is involved in performing rituals. So then the mind is occupied. The possibility of mind's wandering is minimum in puja. So therefore always this is suggested. Start with puja. Then as you become more and more adept, you can drop puja, japa will do. How do you know when to stop puja and when to go to japa? That Bhagwan himself is going to tell you. As you advance in spirituality, you will find the mind more and more settling in God. You will find that mind stops wandering into the worldly activities. When you have more than 80% control of your mind at the seat of meditation, then the grosser techniques can be dropped. So individually we have to find out. Anyway, now first we will focus on puja. What is puja? Later on we will see japa, etc. Bhagwan himself is going to tell what is this puja. Anyway, let us chant the next verse, which talks about puja. What is the highest puja? Verse number 5.
Jagata ishadhi yukta sevanam ashtamurti bhrad deva pujanam. Jagata ishadhi yukta sevanam ashtamurti bhrad deva pujanam.
Here the highest definition of puja is given. What is the best puja you can do? Bhagwan says, Jagata Ishadhi Yukta Sevanam. Jagata Sevanam. Serving the world, thinking that I am serving God Himself. This Bhagwan says, Deva Pujanam. What is the best form of worship? Serving the world with the understanding that I am serving the manifested form of God. This is the highest puja. So what is that form of God? Ashtamurti bhrit deva pujanam. This world which contains ashtamurti, Bhagwan is ashtamurti bhrit. Bhrit means supporter, sustainer. The one who sustains this ashtamurti, that supreme Lord, the best worship is serving the world. Now what are these ashtamurtis? Five elements. What are the five elements? Space, akasha, air, vayu, agni, fire, jala, water, and prithvi, earth, five elements plus heavenly bodies, the one which has its own light and the other one which reflects light. Like for example, sun, it has its own light. So that's the sixth one. Moon, it reflects lights. That's the seventh one. And the eighth one is the living beings, jivas. So who is God? He is Ashtamurti Bhrut, the sustainer of all these eight factors. So what is the best puja? The best puja is see this world as the very manifestation, a visible form of God, and then serve everyone. This will be the highest possible worship. Now in the beginning it is impossible. So therefore what do we do? Fine, you are not able to see God in this world. At least start practicing seeing God in one form. This is called as Murti Puja. So everyone has to start from Murti Puja. What is Murti Puja? Consider a Murti as God and then worship the Murti. That Murti symbolizes God. Now there are a lot of questions which come the moment this Murti Puja comes into picture. Understand, this Murti is a symbolic representation of omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent God. It doesn't mean that only this Murti itself is God and nothing else is God. No. It's a representation. Just like the flag is a representation of the nation. So when you see that flag, you salute the flag. It doesn't mean that that piece of cloth is itself is nation. It is only a representation. In the same way, at present in my immaturity, I am not able to see that God in this whole world. I am trying to practice seeing God in a form. For my own convenience, because of my inability, this method of sadhana has been prescribed. Please understand. Many times people fight in the name of Murti. Now the question is, which Murti to select? Which is the most powerful God? Which is the most powerful God? Rama, Krishna, Jesus, Allah. Which is the most powerful one? Understand, there is only one God. That question itself is wrong. If there are so many gods, then yes, there is this question, who is more powerful? When there is only one God, where is the question of comparison? You choose any God, it doesn't matter. But your understanding has to be clear. There is only one God. For my convenience, I am choosing one particular form. Now in Hinduism, the biggest problem is there are so many gods. In other religion, we don't have this problem. There are almost 33 crore gods, it seems. Naturally, the question comes, why do we have so many gods? Only one was enough. Lot of confusions are created because of so many gods. So our Pujya Gurudev used to answer it very nicely. Suppose you want to go to a restaurant. Will you go to a restaurant where there is only idli sambar, nothing else? Will you go there with your family? No. You want varieties, isn't it? Because different people have different tastes. In the same way, when you go to a cloth shop, or a chappal shop or whatever, you need varieties. In the same way, in Hinduism, you are given with all possible varieties. There is a mall where you can choose your God. Not only human being, you can have a male God or a female God. If you don't want both of them, then you can have animal God. That is also there. If you don't want animal God, okay, mix of animal and man, that is also there. Narasimha avatar is there. All varieties are given to you in Hinduism. That's the greatness of Hinduism. All varieties are given to you. Choose whichever you want. And different moods also. If you are not happy with sattvic mood, yes, terrible moods. Gods with terrible moods are also there. Bhadragalis, etc. are there. The point is, choose one God and start worshipping according to your temperament. The greatness of Hinduism is, whatever level of evolution you are, according to your evolution, a particular sadhana is prescribed for you. If you are highly evolved, then you don't have to do all this. There is only one thing. In this Upadesharam it comes, manasam tuke margane krite naiva manasam marga arjava. This is the path. If you are highly evolved, if you are really qualified, this one thing will do. What is that? Observe your mind. Mind disappears. Finished. You are face to face with the reality. Can you do this? Then you don't need any of this. That path is also prescribed. But then if you say, no, that is too difficult for me. Fine, then come down. So nirguna nirakara dhyana is also there for the most brilliant ones, highly qualified ones, full of all virtues. For them, the highest path is also given. For others who are less evolved, lower paths are also given. Saguna, sakara, upasana is given. Murti puja is given. So understand, according to my evolution, I choose a path. That is the greatness of Hinduism. We are having multi-lane tracks because we know different seekers are in different lanes. Because there are different vehicles. There is a bullock cart also going at 3 kilometers per hour speed. Bullock cart is also there. There is an auto rickshaw is also there. Truck is there. And Mercedes Benz is also there. For all of them, you can't put everyone in the same track. Can you? No. Different seekers are at different evolutionary stages. So accordingly, different paths have to be prescribed. And this is done. This is a unique feature of Hinduism. Everyone has got something or the other. Something or the other sadhana which suits him, which suits his nature. That is a greatness. So one must understand the greatness of Hinduism, and that is why this religion is even today alive. It is called a Sanatana Dharma. At no period of time this way of living can become non-existent. Sanatana, eternal it is. Civilizations have come and gone. So many invasions have taken place, isn't it? So many natural calamities have taken place. But this dharma is one which even today is as alive as it was thousands and thousands of years back. Why is it so? It is so because this Hinduism is able to adapt itself to the changing circumstances, changing situations. It is capable. It has that inbuilt capacity. Anyway, that is not the point here. The point here is, start from Murti Puja also, nothing wrong. But don't become fanatic, saying that my God alone is powerful, all the others are inferior. Don't do that. Many times the people who do Murti Puja, they get into this trouble. That is because the bigger understanding, the bigger picture is not clear to them. Now what is this basically Murti Puja? See, it is something like this. When a guest comes to your house, how do you treat him? How do you treat a guest, a very important guest, whom you love very much, whom you respect very much, revere very much? What do? You start preparing long back, isn't it? So you know that such and such person is going to come tomorrow. So you clean all your houses, keep everything clean. Let me create a good impression in his mind. Things are all in a mess, but you clean everything, isn't it? The place is kept clean, nice food is prepared, all arrangements are made, and when he comes, if he's a holy person, you wash his feet, give a good asana to sit, give him some water to drink, correct? Entertain that person, speak such topics which he is interested in. There are little things to make that person comfortable there, right? And prepare delicious food, serve him, make him happy. This is the way. The same thing happens in Murti Puja also. It is called a Shodasha Upachara Puja. It is the same thing. So you imagine that God is going to visit your house. This is imagination. So first you invoke, you ring bell, etc. Agamartham to devanam, gamanartham to rakshasam. All rakshasas, go away from here. Bhagavan is going to come. Visit my houses. Now these are all mental imagination. You imagine that God has come. You invoke him in a particular murti. Then you do all those, what you call that, achamanam. You wash his feet, give something to drink. Right? Give him bath, give him cloth, put chandan, kumkum, etc. Put garland and then offer naivedyam. So in puja what is happening is, you feel his presence. This is most important. Let not your puja become mechanical. Many times our ritual becomes so mechanical that we don't even feel his presence. Then the purpose of puja is defeated. What is more important is, you have to feel that this God has come and he is seated and he is receiving all my... This should be the attitude. And slowly, slowly what happens, as you keep doing it, you start feeling his presence. So in our scriptures it is said, your puja room should be a separate room. So whenever you enter into that room, you feel the presence of the Lord. And you will find that whenever your mind is disturbed, the moment you get into that room, the mind becomes peaceful. There will be some problem which will be worrying you. And during that puja, you just offer that problem in front of the Lord and you will definitely find some solution. God also responds to your prayer, to your sincere efforts. He responds. It is said, when you take one step, he takes 100 steps. Isn't it? Swami Shivanji used to say, keep the puja room under lock and key. Don't use puja room as a storeroom. So many things are there, unwanted, you dump it in puja room. Don't do that. But nowadays, Swamiji, how can we have separate puja room and all? So nowadays in houses you find the puja room is under the staircase or inside the kitchen. Fine, what else to do if you don't have space? But the point is, when you are doing puja, at least let your mind be totally involved. And as you keep doing this, ultimately your puja has to evolve to what stage? That highest stage is mentioned here. Jagata Ishadhi Yukta Sevanam Ashtamurti Bhrit Deva Pujanam. A time must come when you are able to see that very same Lord in everyone, in everything. You are able to see your Ishta Devata in everything. That is the culmination of puja. Lokmanya Tilak, once he was visiting his friend's house. So his friend had a son, a small boy. And this boy used to love Tilak very much. So one day his friend told Tilakji that, sir, my son, he doesn't do puja. He says, I will not do. So therefore Tilak, he called that son, said, why don't you do puja? Tell me. And the boy said, you are not doing puja, therefore I will also not do puja. And it was true, Tilak was not doing puja. Then Tilak, he just took that boy, went to the terrace. And then he showed the road, you know, all this. What do you see? So people were walking. So he asked this boy, what do you see there? So the boy said, so many people are walking here and there. That is what I see. Then Tilak said, the day when you see gods walking in human form, that day onwards you need not do puja. Till then you must. If you are seeing only human beings there, then you are not mature enough. But instead, if you are seeing gods walking in human form, then you need not do puja. This is called Jagata Ishadhi Yukta Sevanam Ashtamurti Bhrit Deva Pujanam. Well, this is with regard to puja. What about japa? Bhagavan gives some valuable tips with respect to japa. Let us chant verse number 6.
Uttamastavaducha mandatah Chittajam japa dhyanam uttamam उत्तमस्तवादुच्चमन्दतः चित्तजं जप ध्यानमुत्तमम्.
यस, आफ्टर पूजा वी कम टू जप, विच इज मोर सटलर एंड मोर अडवांस्ड मेथड. सो व्हाट डज भगवान से हियर? भगवान सेज दिस जप इज ऑफ थ्री काइंड्स. सो व्हाट डज भगवान से? उत्तमस्तवात. Here, please understand, here Uttama means God. In the English translation, Uttama is given as superior. It is not superior, it is God. Bhagavan is called Uttama, the best. Uttamastava means stotrams of God, related to God, praising God. So the first one is Uttamastava. Start chanting God in some raga, tunes, etc. All bhajans, etc. comes in this. So first is Uttama Stavanam. What does Bhagavan say? Higher than that is Uttama Stavad Uccha. Uccha means loud. Uccha Japa. Higher than chanting stotrams, etc. is loud Japa. What is the definition of loud Japa? Uccha Japa. Parashruti gocharah uccha japah. What is this uccha japah? When others are able to listen to your japah, then that is uccha japah. Higher than uccha japah is mandatah. Uttamastavad uccha mandatah. Manda japah. Higher than uccha japah is manda japah. What is manda japah? Sva shruti gocharah. Only you are able to hear, you are whispering it to yourself. Others are not able to hear. This is called Manda Japa. And higher than that is Chittajam Japa. Mind-born Japa, which Bhagavan calls it as Dhyanam itself. Chittajam Japa Dhyanam Uttamam, the best. Japa where only your mind is involved. So what is the first one? Chanting stotrams, bhajans, etc. Higher than that is uccha japa. Higher than that is manda japa. Higher than that is chittajam japa. Now with regard to japa also, there are so many questions and confusions. Which mantra to chant? Swamiji, tell me which is the most powerful mantra. Then common question. Now what do you say? Gayatri mantra is very, very powerful, it is said. Then there are others who say, no. Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram is the best. Then somebody else says, no. In Kali Santarana Upanishad, it is very clearly mentioned. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare. Very clearly mentioned. In Kali Yuga, this is the only mantra which is going to save you. And remember, everywhere it is written that particular mantra is the highest. Now people are confused. Which mantra to chant? See, the word mantra says, Mananat Trayate Iti Mantraha. Mananat Trayate. Trayate. One which protects. When will the mantra protect you? Mananat. When you chant it regularly. That which protects you when chanted regularly is mantra. So what does it mean? Where actually does the power reside? In the mantra or in you? It is in ourselves. The more and more you chant a mantra, the more and more that mantra becomes powerful for you. This you have to keep in mind. Because there is no other source of power other than you. Because you are none other than God Himself. Tattvamasi, isn't it? Aham Brahmasmi. So who is that God? Me, myself. So if power has to come, from where it has to come? It has to come from me, myself. The more and more you chant a particular mantra, that particular mantra becomes powerful for you. Understand this. Don't foolishly fight or waste your time choosing which mantra to chant. And keep this in mind. Once you have chosen one mantra, stick to it. Don't chant seven mantras or 7 days. One on Shiva, one on Devi, one on Ganapati.
Some people are like that,
especially ladies. 1 month day is allocated for 1 month deity. And they feel that if I don't chant this, then Ganapati will be angry with me. Devi will be... Remember, God is only one. Choose one Ishta Devata, choose one mantra. If you want to strike water, if you keep on digging everywhere, will you strike water? No. Keep digging in the same place. Then you will see water. In the same way, when you chant a mantra, keep this in mind, chant one. To such an extent that even in dream, when some bad dream you see, this mantra should come out. If you chant 10 mantras, which mantra will come out? Nothing will come out. Isn't it? Even your subconscious mind must chant that mantra. And this will happen only when you are sticking to one. Make it a habit. Daily, for years together, when you chant, that mantra enters into your subconscious mind. So even in sleep, that chanting goes on. So who gives momentum to this? Your own chanting. And the momentum gains with more and more practice. Don't worry which mantra is powerful, etc. Yes, certain gurus, they say, this mantra is very, very powerful. It is only to instill faith in you, that's all. Only when you have faith in a particular mantra, you will feel like chanting it, isn't it? In order to instill that faith, some gurus, they say, this is the most powerful mantra, etc. It is only to instill faith. And some gurus, they give diksha also. Mantra diksha they give. What is the purpose of mantra diksha? Remember, just because you got mantra diksha from a very great saint, doesn't mean that mantra is going to protect you. No. No doubt it has got its own importance. When you receive a mantra diksha from a great saint, your faith in that mantra is reinforced. That is the purpose. But effort has to come from you yourself. These are the things which we must very clearly understand. Swamiji, if we chant the mantra wrongly, will it have any side effect? Another question. As long as your devotion is there, even if the mantra is chanted wrongly, nothing will happen to you. It will only bless you. It's a very nice story. So one devotee went to a guru. He said, Guru, give me one mantra to chant. So then guru said, fine, you chant this name of God, Aghamochan. What is that? Aghamochan. Agha means sin. Mochan means the one who liberates you from sin. Aghamochan. Chant this. And this devotee was very, very, devoted. He started chanting this mantra. Now, what he heard was not Aghamochan, he heard only Ghamochan. And he started chanting Ghamochan, Ghamochan, Ghamochan. Maybe after a few years or so, once Vishnu in his Vaikuntha was smiling. So Lakshmi asked, O Lord, why are you smiling? So Vishnu said, I am just thinking of my wonderful devotees and thus I am smiling. Then Vishnu said, there is one devotee who is chanting my name wrongly, Ghamochan. So then Lakshmi said, come on, let us test him. So both of them went in disguise. Old man and old woman. So Vishnu went as took the form of an old man. He hid himself behind a tree. And this Lakshmi took the form of an old woman and she approached him. Now this fellow was sitting there, Ghamochan, Ghamochan, chanting. So Lakshmi asked, no, she was in the form of an old woman, whose name are you chanting? Devotee said, your husband's name. She was shocked. Where is he? This devotee said, right behind that tree, he is hiding there. Now this devotee did not know. Now what I am trying to say is, whatever the way you chant, that name has got its own power. It will reveal everything to you. What is important is your sincerity, your commitment, your dedication. That is what counts. Now many times this japa becomes mechanical. What to do or what is the problem? This is one of the major problems faced by all seekers. Japa becomes mechanical. Means what? You are chanting, but the mind is going somewhere. What is the problem? The problem is lack of love for God. Simple. Remember, japa is not the first step, japa is second. After puja comes japa. In puja, if you have not developed sufficient love for God, japa can become mechanical and dry. When God is a stranger for you, chanting the name of a stranger, will it give any kind of joy or solace to you? Not possible. Only when you have developed a strong bond, a strong relationship, then only that name will have any meaning in your life. Isn't it? Suppose I ask you to remember your grandson, a small child, maybe 5 years. Is it any difficult to chant his name and fill your heart with love? Is it difficult? It's not difficult because you love, so naturally taking his name is wonderful, isn't it? Sweet. So if while taking the name of the Lord you find that your heart is dry, your mind is running here and there, what does it mean? There is no love. Wherever there is love, concentration becomes automatic, natural. So that is why the first step prescribed is puja. In puja, you develop this relationship with God. Please keep in mind, you have to have one relationship with God, whatever the way. Master-servant relationship, mother-child relationship, father-son relationship, whatever it is. Lover-beloved relationship, take up one relationship and develop on it. And whenever you think of God, invoke this particular relationship every time. Then that relationship becomes stronger. So once you have developed sufficient love for God, once that relationship has been strengthened, then that name will not be a mere name for you. Because when you chant that name, you are invoking that relationship. That is why many times japa becomes dry. Because that relationship is not there. Love is not there. Mere chanting is happening. And that person, for few days he chants and then stops. Enough. But once you have got the taste of it, the joy of it, once you start feeling his presence the moment you chant, then japa becomes an excellent exercise. Because puja has some defects. The greatest defect is you can't do puja everywhere. Suppose you are traveling in the train, you can't do puja there. But japa is something which you can do there also. Isn't it? Minimum accessories are needed. Maybe one japa mala is enough. Bas. Anywhere, any time, you can do japa. Even in your bathroom also, you can do japa. Isn't it? It's possible. But for that, you must have developed that kind of relationship. A very potent sadhana, japa is. Very powerful. Consciously, when you do japa, the wanderings of the mind stops. Your concentration improves. Single-pointedness. Mind becomes single-pointed. Uttamastavad uchchamandatah chittajam japa dhyanam uttamam. After japa comes chintana. What is that chintana? We will see tomorrow. Om sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhadrani pasyantu, ma kaschid dukha bhag bhavet, asato ma sadgamaya, tamaso ma jyotirgamaya, mrityorma amritam gamaya. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.